Surely heed me, O God. Turn your ear to me. Hear my words. Guard me as the apple of your eye. In the shadow of your wings, protect me.
In the shadow of your wings, protect me.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And with your spirit.
Good morning again, and welcome to this celebration. It's Sunday, it's the Sabbath, it's the Lord's Day. We give glory and praise to God every day, but most especially on this sacred day, for it is the day that the Lord has made for us to celebrate his joy, his love, and his great mercy. We come here to encounter Jesus, first in his word, which then always leads us to his table, to the altar of sacrifice, to the Eucharist, where we are nourished on his very life, his body and blood, his soul and divinity. But we also encounter him in one another, because where two or three are gathered in his name, he is in our midst. So let's take a moment now and greet one another and the Christ that's in present in each of us. Brothers and sisters, let us acknowledge our sins and so prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries.
You are sent to heal the contrite of heart. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
You came to call sinners. Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
You are seated at the right hand of the Father to intercede for us. Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy on us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life. Almighty ever-living God, grant that we may always conform our will to yours and serve your majesty in sincerity of heart. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of Exodus. In those days, Amalek came and waged war against Israel. Moses, therefore, said to Joshua, "Pick out certain men, and tomorrow go out and engage Amalek in battle. I will be standing on top of the hill with the staff of God in my hand." So Joshua did as Moses told him. He engaged Amalek in battle. After Moses had climbed to the top of the hill with Aaron and Hur. As long as Moses kept his hands raised up, Israel had the better of the fight. But when he let his hands rest, Amalek had the better of the fight. Moses' hands, however, grew tired, so they put a rock in place for him to sit on. Meanwhile, Aaron and Hur supported his hands, one on one side and one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till sunset. And Joshua mowed down Amalek and his people with the edge of the sword.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Your shade. He is beside you at your
A reading from the second letter of St. Paul to Timothy. Beloved, remain faithful to what you have learned and believed, because you know from where you learned it, and that from infancy you have known the sacred scriptures, which are capable of giving you wisdom for salvation through faith in Christ Jesus. All scripture is inspired by God and is useful for teaching, for refutation, for correction, and for training in righteousness, so that one who belongs to God may be competent, equipped for every good work. I charge you in the presence of God and of Christ Jesus, who will judge the living and the dead, and by his appearing and his kingly power, proclaim the word. Be persistent, whether it is convenient or inconvenient. Convince, reprimand, encourage through all patience and teaching.
The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke.
Glory to you, Lord.
Jesus told his disciples a parable about the necessity for them to pray always without becoming weary. He said, "There was a judge in a certain town who neither feared God nor respected any human being. And a widow in that town used to come to him and say, 'Render a just decision for me against my adversary.' For a long time, the judge was unwilling, but eventually he thought, 'While it is true that I neither fear God nor respect any human being, because this widow keeps bothering me, I shall deliver a just decision for her, lest she finally come and strike me.' The Lord said, 'Pay attention to what the dishonest judge says. Will not God then secure the rights of his chosen ones who call out to him day and night? Will he be slow to answer them? I tell you, he will see to it that justice is done for them speedily. But when the Son of Man comes, will he find faith on earth?" The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
Be persistent, whether it's convenient or inconvenient. The words of St. Paul to the younger Timothy in our first reading today. And that persistence, that perseverance, or putting it in more modern jargon, hang in there, is really what our gospel is teaching us today as well. It's obvious from our readings, as well as we look hopefully deeply into our own lives, that we do need God's help. Left to our own devices, we sometimes can pretty well mess things up. We need God's help to fight life's battles. I like the image in our first reading, Moses, Joshua, they're fighting an enemy, and they got Moses to a point where he was propped up with his hands up. Now, this was not magical or superstition, because raised hands like this in the ancient world of the Jews was a form of praying. I still do it at Mass. When I say, "Let us pray," I extend my hands open like this. So it's a symbol of Moses praying to God, interceding. But then he got physically weary. His arms went down. Then they started losing the battle. So then he had to raise them up again. Now they propped him up. They put two pillars beneath his arms so that his arms won't go down. He will persist in his praying. But in the midst of our gospel today, in which Jesus, through this parable of the persistent widow, Jesus makes a rather strange statement at the very end of the gospel. I suppose we could say it's a rhetorical question. After declaring that God will certainly answer humble and persistent prayers, then Jesus asks the question, "But when the Son of Man returns, when he comes again, will he find faith on earth?" What is our take on that question? Well, certainly Jesus is referring to his second coming at the end of time, at the end of history, when the final judgment will take place. And Jesus is wondering out loud about whether there will be anyone left at that time who really believes in him. Now, some people have taken that statement of Jesus and maybe misinterpreted it a little bit. Some have interpreted it to mean that the church in those end days will slowly shrink away as history unfolds, and only a very small remnant handful of believers will be left. Well, what does the church teach on that? Well, first of all, the Catechism of the Catholic Church does tell us that at the end of history, at the end of time, as the end of the world draws near, there will be an intensity of good versus evil in the world. But at the same time, the Gospels tell us that Christ will not return until the good news has been preached and reaches all the ends of the earth. I suppose we can take some momentary comfort then to know that it has not yet been preached to the ends of the earth. There are still places in this world where they do not know Christ. He has not been preached. We still have time, thankfully. And also remember the parable of the mustard seed that represents the church, beginning very small and insignificant, but growing into this huge tree. That parable also indicates that the church will continue to grow until the very end of time. And so what is Jesus really getting at when he poses this rhetorical question? Will the Son of Man, when he comes back, find faith on this earth? He's really bearing his heart to us. Jesus did that quite a bit. He opened up his heart in a beautiful way in his teachings. He's just promised us that God will never abandon us. But Jesus also knows that some of us might be tempted to and may very well abandon God. And that saddens our Lord deeply. He hopes, by expressing his concern, to confirm our decision to be persistent, to persevere in our trust, to follow him through the thick and the thin. Friendships, if they're true and real, are really risky business when you think about it. And Christ has taken on to himself perhaps the greatest risk of all by asking for our friendship. This is what's most unique about our Christian faith. Only in Christianity does the one true, all-powerful God actually desire our friendship. Only in our Christian faith does God desire our friendship. In all the other religions of the world, God certainly desires worship, loyalty, fidelity, among other things, but never friendship. Only in Christianity does God actually come down to our level in order to raise us up to his level so that we can live in a real, in a true, and everlasting friendship, a relationship with him. And that's why Jesus becomes sad when he thinks about all the people who are going to give up on him because his friendship is real. And as we all well know, that when we lose a friend, it really hurts. Friendship, of course, is based on genuine love. And as I said, loving is always risky. And Jesus took the greatest risk of all when he came into this world and continues to be in our world amongst us, to search us out, each one of us by name, and to invite us into a relationship with him and to follow him to his kingdom. Jesus knew that in order to offer himself in that friendship, he had to become vulnerable. And it had to be always a possibility then that we could reject him. Just look at Jesus hanging on that cross. Look at that pierced side and heart from the soldier's lance. This is what love risks. This is love's vulnerability. Jesus has shown us that he is willing to take this tremendous risk with us, and that in and of itself, it shows us how much he values our friendship, how much he longs for it. He longs for each and every one of us to follow him, to learn from him, and to help him to build up his kingdom in this world. There's so much more work to do in this crazy world we live in, day after day, in good times and in bad, as he leads each and every one of us to his Father's house. If we are willing to accept that invitation, we have nothing to fear. Because when it comes to the friendship of Jesus Christ, that vulnerability only goes in one direction. We may hurt Jesus by preferring our own will over his divine will, when we are unfaithful to God. But Jesus will never hurt us. He will never be unfaithful to us. Now, I'm sure all of us gathered here today, none of us wants to abandon Jesus. Yet we know that it's possible that as we go through life's difficulties and temptations, that we can easily get worn down. Our resistance gets low. Is there some secret formula for fidelity to our friendship with Jesus Christ? I wish it was as simple as a little vitamin pill, but it doesn't work that way. But there is a secret formula. It's no coincidence that Jesus' rhetorical question at the end of our gospel comes after his parable about praying and the persistence in praying. Prayer is the secret weapon. We should all know that. Prayer is what keeps us connected. It's what keeps us online. It's what keeps the flow of grace from God to help strengthen our weaknesses, and we are weak, to enlighten our ignorance, and boy, we are ignorant, and to help defend us against the wiles of the evil one, the temptations that are always there. Now, all of us pray. That's why we're here today. We're praying right now in this Mass. But there's an important thing we got to remember. Prayer, like everything else in life, if we're not getting better at it, then we are actually getting worse at it. And the devil can easily see this. He takes advantage of all the little loose chinks in our armor, so to speak. You know, the devil usually doesn't separate us from Jesus in one some big giant bang of a way, instigating total rebellion. That's not how the devil works. He works in very subtle ways. He loves it when we compromise our faith little by little. So instead, he tries to draw us away little by little. And one of his first tactics that he throws at us is to convince us that it's okay to cut corners in our prayer life. You know, it's really not hard to give God so many minutes a day in prayer. I know a number of you are good prayers already, but maybe a number of us are still really struggling in that. It's sporadic. We only pray when we really think we need to pray or when we feel like praying. We'll never get good at praying if that's how our prayer life is. It needs to be consistent. It needs to be persistent. So start off always simply. 10 minutes in the morning. 5 minutes in the middle of the day. 10 more at night. You know, you think about it. Of all the time we spend listening to all our favorite music, watching all our favorite TV shows, and then amazingly how much time we spend in front of that computer every day. An awful lot of our day is spent on those things. And yet, when it comes to prayer, we think that that short period of time is too demanding in our schedules. Today, let's just let the devil know that he needs to go back to where he came from. And today, Jesus, once again in this liturgy, is renewing his commitment to us. We never need to worry about his commitment to us. As he gives us himself in the Eucharist, his body and blood, his soul, his divinity. And as he does that, as he renews that commitment to us, let's respond by once again renewing our commitment to him, promising that we will never let a day go by in which we spend at least a few minutes in heartfelt prayer, the secret weapon for staying faithful to Jesus our Lord. We now stand and profess our faith as we say together, I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us men and for our salvation, from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. We are all called to pray always without becoming weary. And so we pray, and our response is, bless your people, Lord. Bless your people, Lord.
For Pope Francis and all of our church leaders, may they help us faithfully persevere in prayer during this Jubilee Year of Mercy. We pray.
Bless your people, Lord.
For our civil leaders, may God give them the grace and courage to protect religious freedom. We pray.
Bless your people, Lord.
For the poor, sick, and dying, and for those suffering from natural disasters, may they know the power of our persistent prayers. We pray.
Bless your people, Lord.
For the most vulnerable among us, may all life be cherished from conception until natural death, and for the care and support of mothers, fathers, and the elderly, we pray.
Bless your people, Lord.
For Tony Moretti and Rob Walter, who were united in the sacrament of matrimony, and for all married couples, may they be strengthened by their faith in Christ. We pray.
Bless your people, Lord.
For all members of Most Blessed Sacrament Parish and their families, in particular for Elise, Carly, and Maren Gorman, for intentions in our prayer books and on our prayer line, and for the intentions we hold in our hearts. We pray.
Bless your people, Lord.
For all of our loved ones who have died, in particular we pray for Randall Davis and Dan Schneider. May they know the peace of heaven. We pray.
Bless your people, Lord. O God, you hear the prayers of those who cry out to you. Help us to persevere in prayer that we might one day live with you forever. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. And I will delight in your commandments, which I love. And I will lift up my hands to your commands and meditate on your statutes. And I will lift up my hands to your commands and meditate on your statutes. Brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept this sacrifice at your hands for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Grant us, Lord, we pray, a sincere respect for your gifts, that through the purifying action of your grace, we may be cleansed by the very mysteries we serve, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right to give you thanks, truly just to give you glory, Father most holy. For you are the one God living and true, existing before all ages, and abiding for all eternity, dwelling in unapproachable light. Yet you, who alone are good, the source of life, have made all that is, so that you might fill your creatures with blessings and bring joy to many of them by the glory of your light. And so in your presence are countless hosts of angels who serve you day and night, and gazing upon the glory of your face, glorify you without ceasing. With them we too confess your name and exaltation, giving voice to every creature under heaven as we acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
We give you praise, Father most holy, for you are great. You have fashioned all your works in wisdom and in love. You formed man in your own image and entrusted the whole world to his care, so that in serving you alone, the Creator, he might have dominion over all creatures. And when through disobedience he had lost your friendship, you did not abandon him to the domain of death. You came in mercy to the aid of all, so that those who seek might find you. Time and again you offered them covenants, and through the prophets taught them to look forward to salvation. And you so loved the world, Father most holy, that in the fullness of time you sent your only begotten Son to be our Savior, made incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He shared our human nature in all things but sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation. To prisoners, freedom. To the sorrowful of heart, joy. To accomplish your plan, he gave himself up to death. And rising from the dead, he destroyed death and restored life, and that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose again for us. He sent the Holy Spirit from you, Father, as the first fruits for those who believe, so that bringing to perfection his work in the world, he might sanctify creation to the full. Therefore, O Lord, we pray, may this same Holy Spirit graciously sanctify these offerings, that they may become the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, for the celebration of this great mystery which he himself left us as an eternal covenant. For when the hour had come for him to be glorified by you, Father most holy, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. And while they were at supper, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, taking the chalice filled with the fruit of the vine, he gave thanks and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me."
The mystery of faith.
When we eat this bread and drink this cup,
we proclaim
your death, O Lord, until you come again.
Therefore, O Lord, Lord, as we now celebrate the memorial of our redemption, we remember Christ's death, his descent to the realm of the dead. We proclaim his resurrection and his ascension to your right hand. And as we await his coming in glory, we offer you his body and blood, the sacrifice acceptable to you, which brings salvation to the whole world. Look, O Lord, upon the sacrifice which you yourself have provided for your church, and grant us in your loving kindness to all who partake of this one bread and one chalice that gathered into the one body by the Holy Spirit, they may truly become a living sacrifice in Christ to the praise of your glory. Therefore, Lord, remember now all for whom we offer this sacrifice, especially your servant Francis, our Pope, David, our Bishop, the whole order of bishops, all the clergy, those who take part in this offering, those gathered here before you, your entire people, and all who seek you with a sincere heart. Remember also those who have died in the peace of your Christ and all the dead, whose faith you alone have known. To all of us, your children, grant, O merciful Father, that we may enter into a heavenly inheritance with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Blessed Joseph, her spouse, and with your apostles and saints in your kingdom, there with the whole of creation, freed from the corruption of sin and death, may we glorify you through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good.
Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command and form of divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church. Graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
Peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Behold, the eyes of the Lord are on those who fear him, who hope in his merciful love, to rescue their souls from death, to keep them alive in famine,
to keep them alive in famine.
Thank you. Please be seated. This time I invite Lynn forward, who will be taking communion to the homebound residents over at North Point. Today we have celebrated with joy this Lord's Day, and as you go now to the residents of North Point, administer to them faithfully this most blessed sacrament with our love and prayers. As you pray with them, please ask them to pray for us. Go in peace. Spirits
who prowl about the world seeking the ruin of souls. Amen.
Let us pray. Grant grant, O Lord, we pray, that benefiting from participation in heavenly things, we may be helped by what you give in this present age and prepared for the gifts that are eternal. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
We do have hospitality in the back, all kinds of goodies back there, so be sure you stop back there at the end of Mass for some little good treats and some good fellowship as well. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth. The Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.
Oh, bless the Lord.